Good evening and welcome to Alice Foundation's series of classes on the basics of Christianity and Islam. Tonight is our sixth and final class, Muslim-Christian Encounters. My name is Richard Saxer. I am a Christian and a member of Trinity Episcopal Church in New Orleans. I'm the moderator of this series. Our instructors are Father Buddy Noel, a Roman Catholic priest, the ecumenical officer of the Archdiocese of New Orleans, and pastor of two Catholic parishes in the New Orleans area, and Dr. Fevzi Sarak. Dr. Fevzi is professor of political science with Louisiana State University in Baton Rouge. Our technical guru who keeps us online and in line is Hassan Suzuki. We all are with the Atlas Foundation of Louisiana. Last week, Father Buddy and Dr. Fevzi spoke about Jesus, Mary, John the Baptist, and Zechariah. This evening, they're speaking to us about Muslim-Christian encounters. As we begin now, please remain on mute, but send me your questions or comments through chat. After their talks, we'll get our presenters to answer them and have more discussion with us. Thank you. Our first speaker tonight is Father Buddy. Father Buddy.
Good evening, everyone. So in our last session tonight, we're going to talk about, in the second slide, Hassan, our mutual encounters as Christians and Muslims. And Fevzi is going to talk about the earliest encounters. I'm going to pick up with what I would call an age of collaboration, if you will, in which during the early centuries of Islam, Islamic centers such as Damascus and Baghdad in Spain, Jewish, Christian, and Muslims interacted freely with each other, and particularly the scholars. And that's of vast importance for all of us, even today, that far from rejecting each other because of their different religious traditions, they saw in each other an opportunity to learn from each other and to share knowledge. And that's a wonderful notion. And there it was at the very beginning that we all tended to work together. And when we did that in places like Al-Andalus in Spain and in Baghdad in Iraq and Damascus in Syria, we advanced in medicine, in mathematics, and astronomy. There were ancient texts that were preserved and translated into Arabic, especially the writings of Aristotle, the great philosopher of ancient Greece. And by simply doing that, by translating Aristotle into Arabic, the Muslims and the Jews and the Christians preserved that for the future. And that has huge implications for the future of philosophy and theology in the Christian West. So, you know, I think that that's something that a lot of people don't know or don't think about these days. But, and then the reason for that is that we were all together in this back then. And I can't emphasize that enough, how important that is. Collaboration is so important, and it's so good, and you learn so much from it. And I have a little image there of scholars studying in this time period. Non-Muslims offered prosper in Islamic society, rising sometimes to positions of authority in their governments. And Jews and Christians were protected under Islamic law and were allowed their own religious courts, their own religious services, and their own houses of worship. Okay? So this is a very interesting period in history that's not studied well enough. And I think, thankfully, it is beginning to be better known today. Next slide, please. As an aside, this is a great figure in early Christianity, John of Damascus. He's commemorated in both the Eastern Orthodox and the Roman Catholic churches on the 4th of December. He was born around the year 675. The Common Era dies around 749. And he was said to have served like his father in the court of the caliph, the Islamic caliph, the ruler in Damascus, prior to his service as a monk in the Marsaba Abbey monastery near Jerusalem. And that's where he wrote his works. He was a brilliant thinker and theologian and a philosopher, and also wrote treatises on medicine, and also he was a hymnographer. He wrote hymns for the Christian church that are still sung in the Orthodox church today. So he was skilled in both Arabic and Greek. And he is sort of the Christian side of this collaboration. So you can see him as a figure who benefited from this collaboration, and he is noteworthy in that he is one of the first Christians to comment on Islam and the Quran, which it is obvious that he has read at least parts of it. And though in his treatise he expresses significant differences with the new movement of Islam, obviously, his writings are an attempt to understand the new faith of Islam. And something else I think historians would be really keen to observe here is that, you know, just a purely historical point of view, that the basic tenets of the faith of Islam, the text of the Quran from which he quotes, are very clearly in place in John's time. So I think just from an historical point of view, that's really fascinating, that we know that there's historical veracity in both the text of the Quran and in the basic tenets of the faith of Islam, which John clearly speaks about in his work that he wrote. Next slide, please. And there I have a picture of the famous philosopher Averroes, or Ibn Rushd. Before him comes a Persian writer. These are great Muslim thinkers of the medieval era. And again, vastly not well known in the West, unfortunately. Both of these figures are of huge importance for the modern era in which we live. Because the Persian writer Ibn Sina, or Avicenna, wrote works on philosophy and medicine, including the canon of medicine, which was taught in medieval universities in the West, even into the 17th century, was vastly influential. And Averroes himself, you look at his time period a little later, 1126 to 1198, he was from Cordoba in Spain. He wrote an extensive commentary on Aristotle, on the great philosopher Aristotle, which influenced, again, Christian philosophy and theology in the West. And he was a tremendous influence on Thomas Aquinas, the great Catholic writer of the Summa Theologiae, which is a compendium of Catholic theology, which is still studied today in seminaries. Thomas Aquinas owes a lot to Averroes and his commentary on Aristotle. So an Islamic thinker studying Aristotle influences Aquinas, a Christian, and, you know, if it weren't for Averroes, where would we Catholics be today? It's just fascinating, that the interconnection. And most importantly, Thomas Aquinas had the wherewithal to pick up a text by a Muslim and say, "This is great stuff. I really, really think it's wonderful, and I am going to use it because it's good." Regardless of a difference of position on the theological aspects of this other person's faith, I'm going to use this material because it's good and it's helpful, and I'm going to use it. And it shows that people like Thomas Aquinas were very broad-minded people. And that's how we should be today. And there are places at times later in Christian history, and some places before, in which that was not the case, in which there were other people of other traditions were held in suspicion. So it's kind of sad, but you see a person like Aquinas, an openness and a willingness to learn from others. And I think that's fantastic and should be better well known. Now, everything is not wonderful in this collaboration. There is also a sort of an undercurrent of complexity at the same time. And we know that, you know, non-Muslims were in Islamic countries' territory subject to taxes, the jizya. That tax was on every male non-Muslim in the Islamic territory that they owed every year to the authority. Non-Muslims were not allowed to proselytize, by and large, not allowed to build new houses of worship, though they were allowed to fix what they had. And sometimes they were made to wear special identifying garb. And these kinds of aspects sort of come and go in Islamic history. They come and go in Christian history as well, during the Roman Empire, the Christian Roman Empire, as sometimes Jews were looked down upon and mistreated. These things happen. They're human things. Occasionally, persecutions break out. Under the Sultan Hakim in the 11th century, he destroyed the Church of the Holy Sepulchre in Jerusalem and harassed Christian pilgrims. And these kinds of actions eventually lead to religious wars, which called much later by historians the Crusades. They certainly weren't called that at the time. So there is complication, and don't want to deny that. Nevertheless, I do not think that in any way, shape, or form should have ever eclipsed the age of collaboration which came before. And sadly, there were various reasons for that happening, but just wanted to mention that. So we move on. But during this time, there are individual encounters which are very, very important for us to reflect upon. A pope, Pope Gregory VII, who was pope from the year 1073 to 1085, he wrote to a Muslim prince, Ansir, in Mauritania, and he said, "We and you must show in a special way to the other nations an example of this charity, for we believe and confess one God, although in different ways, and praise and worship him daily as the creator of all ages and the ruler of this world." That text is actually quoted in modern Catholic documents as an example of interfaith dialogue in an age which knew very little of it. And so fantastic and forward-looking as well. And the most famous encounter of all, in September of the year 1219, Francis of Assisi, the great founder in Europe from Italy, from Assisi in Italy, about 80 miles north of Rome, who founded the Order of Friars Minor, an order of religious, of simple friars, brothers and sisters, who lived in community and prayed and tried to preach and teach as Jesus had done in the streets, in simplicity and poverty. He goes to a place of conflict and there tries to bring peace and dialogue. He meets there in Egypt with the Sultan. In the midst of the Crusades, the Sultan Al-Kamil, who was the nephew of Saladin in the year 1219. And the Sultan could have immediately had him beheaded, but he did not. He wanted to hear this simple little friar from Italy. And they became friends. They talked for several days. They did not convert each other, but they parted friends. And the records show very clearly that this friendship was the fruit of their dialogue. And that after Francis encountered the Sultan, he was given a couple of gifts by the Sultan. The Sultan gave him some sort of medal or medallion that he was to wear, and he got free passage from Egypt across through to the Holy Land, where he was able to go to Jerusalem and see the holy sites there in a time when that was not possible. And he was able to see the holy sites of his faith with the blessing of the Sultan. You see, when you're nice, what happens? And also, he was very impressed by how the muezzin, who was a soldier, would blow a silver horn, because they had no mosques and in no towers to stand in and call to prayer for the prayers of the day for the Muslim soldiers. And so the muezzin would blow a horn to call the soldiers to do their daily prayers. And Francis was very impressed with that. And he asked the Sultan, "Could I have one?" And the Sultan said, "Sure, my friend." And he gave it to him. And Francis learned to use it. And that silver horn from the Sultan is still in the chapter house in Assisi after all these centuries, that Francis learned to call his brothers to prayer using a silver prayer horn from the Muslims. Isn't that wonderful? So anyways, we move on. So I have to skip many centuries because sadly, things did not always go well. There were continued wars and continued misunderstandings, narratives and counter narratives between the Islamic world and the Christian world. There was the rise of the Ottoman Empire, and which spread into the Balkans and into Greece. And they were twice at the gates of Vienna with their cannons. There was the fall of Constantinople in 1453 before that. There was the Black Death even earlier, which led to suspicion on both sides that somehow we had caused that for the other. So that was certainly not true. Viruses, as we know today, know no boundaries. There was the loss of Islamic Spain. There was the expulsion of Muslims from Spain. And all those things, counteroffensives like the Battle of Lepanto and so forth and so on, that ultimately led to a hardening of positions on both sides. But then there were attempts in the modern era of rapprochement, of dialogue. And one very, very interesting example of that, and I was going to bring down a book I have on his sort of a biography and a discussion of his thought, a figure I think who also deserves much more attention today was the French scholar and Orientalist Louis Massignon, who was born 1883, died 1962. And he was a soldier, and he was in Iraq in 1908. And he had already become very, very interested in Islamic culture and thought. And he believed that he had come to faith in his own tradition through the intercession of a Sufi mystic from the 9th century, Al-Halaj. And he believed that Al-Halaj appeared to him in a dream, and this was part of his journey back to faith in the one God through Christianity. But he always loved the Islamic tradition, and because of his interest in Al-Halaj and other speakers and thinkers of the time, and through Islamic tradition, he immersed himself. He fell in love with Islamic culture, and this became his life's mission, to bring the two traditions together, to have us in dialogue, not at each other's throats. And he actually supposedly met Pope Pius XI. I don't know if this is true or if it is a apocryphal, but he says to him, "You are in fact a Muslim Catholic." and it is known that Louis Massignon, who was married, a Latin Catholic, and Latin priests aren't supposed to marry, he had a wife, yet he decided to become an Eastern Catholic. And it's too complicated to tell you the difference between the two, but Eastern Catholic priests get married. And basically there were Orthodox who became in communion with the Pope at various times in the recent past, last 500 years. And he became an Eastern Catholic, and they are Catholics who use Eastern liturgy and live primarily in Syria and Palestine and Lebanon. And so he became a priest of this tradition so he could chant the liturgy, the Christian liturgy in Arabic. And as he said, live in the shadow of the mosque, because he loved Islam and as a Catholic. And it is because of him, really, that we speak of Abrahamic faiths. He is one of those who championed and pioneered the use of that terminology for our dialogue. And so it was really his insight, it was his influence that ultimately led Pope John the 23rd and later Paul the 6th, his successor as Pope, the two popes that both initiated and completed the Second Vatican Council, to write the final document of the council, one of the final documents, which was called Nostra Aetate, which is Latin for in our time. And it is officially referred to as the Declaration on the Relation of the Catholic Church to Non-Christian Religions. And the very famous statement of the council in Nostra Aetate reads, "The Church regards with esteem, also the Muslims. They adore the one God, living and subsisting in himself, merciful and all-powerful, the creator of heaven and earth, who has spoken to men. They take pains to submit wholeheartedly to even his inscrutable decrees, just as Abraham, with whom the faith of Islam takes pleasure in linking itself, submitted to God. Though they do not acknowledge Jesus as God, they revere him as a prophet. They also honor Mary, his virgin mother. At times, they even call on her with devotion. In addition, they await the day of judgment, when God will render their deserts to all those who have been raised up from the dead. Finally, they value the moral life and worship God, especially through prayer, almsgiving, and fasting. Since in the course of centuries, not a few quarrels and hostilities have arisen between Christians and Muslims, this sacred synod or gathering urges all to forget the past and to work sincerely for mutual understanding and to preserve as well as to promote together the benefit of all mankind's social justice and moral welfare, as well as peace and freedom." So this is the famous third paragraph of Nostra Aetate, the Vatican document of Vatican II, which is of huge importance because it shows us that the Church of Rome, the Christian faith, reaches out in love to our Islamic brothers and sisters. That's what we want to do. And Pope, all the subsequent popes, including Pope Francis, have tried to wholeheartedly engage this document and put it into practice and to push it forward. So I have one more slide that will show us that this document we are looking at now, the very recent last year gathering with Pope Francis and the Grand Imam Sheikh Ahmed Al Tayyib of Al Azhar University in Cairo in Egypt, and the statement, the document on human fraternity, which Pope Francis flew to Abu Dhabi and signed there with the Grand Imam. And I'm just there are certain these aspects that they agreed together to declare the adoption of a culture of dialogue as the path, mutual cooperation as the code of conduct, reciprocal understanding as the method and standard. They call them world leaders to work strenuously to spread the culture of tolerance and of living together in peace, to intervene at the earliest opportunity to stop the shedding of innocent blood, and to bring an end to wars, conflicts, environmental decay, and the moral and cultural decline that the world is presently experiencing. They ask leaders and would-be influencers to rediscover the values of peace, justice, goodness, beauty, human fraternity, and coexistence in order to confirm the importance of these values as anchors of salvation for all and to promote them everywhere. And finally, they said that terrorism is deplorable and threatens the security of people, be they in the East or the West, the North or the South, and it disseminates panic, terror, and pessimism. But this is not due to religion, even when terrorists instrumentalize it. It is due rather to an accumulation of incorrect interpretations, rather, of religious texts and to policies linked to hunger, poverty, injustice, oppression, and pride. So in that one beautiful document there, signed by a leader of the Christian world and a leader of the Islamic world, we wish to declare a culture of dialogue wherein we can grow together and better appreciate each other, love each other, and see each other as brothers and sisters of faith and move forward in this world to build a better one. So I'm going to let it go there. I'm happy to answer questions later.
Thank you, Father Buddy. And Dr. Fevzi.
Okay, so do you hear me right now?
Yes.
Great. I mean, it is our last day and I am very excited. Thanks for everybody giving this opportunity to me. I learned a lot while I am trying to teach. So it was a great opportunity for me too. And what we did get in this course, first, we started from faith, then we went to practices, we went through different sects, then we delved into Christianity and the life of Jesus, Mary, John the Baptist, and Zechariah. And this week, we will dig into the Muslim-Christian encounters historically. Till this week, I tried to stuck in, or limit myself with talking in terms of from the perspective of theology. But this week I will change my perspective and I will talk more on social background because or historical or economic backgrounds of these encounters, because these communal encounters respectively request a social encounters or economic encounters or some historical perspective. So let's start from the first era of Islam. I mean, we talked about in week four the first connection between Muslims and Christians from theological perspective. And as you realized, as you remember, we talked about a chapter in Quran. The name of the chapter is the Romans. And the Quran itself became a side of a conflict in favor of Christians in times of a conflict between Persians and Christians at the time. And the first migration is also to a Christian land at time of Muhammad, when he was oppressed, when Muslims was oppressed in their own country, in their own lands, they decided to move another land, which was right now Ethiopia and Eritrea area. And the main reason besides that decision is there is a Christian king over there and he's a just ruler. He's a fair person. And he, the ruler of Abyssinia, did not give up Muslims though many diplomatic efforts coming from Mecca, coming from Arabia, and asking, requesting deportation of Muslims from the land. And you can see many other connections in times of the life of Muhammad himself. One of them is interesting. The delegation from the community of Najran Christians is coming to visit Muhammad at 631. And actually they are coming and they are staying in Medina, in the city of Prophet. And they exchange scholarly discussions among each other. In many perspectives, they agree on some issues, but in some of the issues, they don't agree on. And they signed a negotiation at the end. And the Najran Christians were agreed to pay taxes to get some protection from the state, from the Islamic State. And also the state is assuring their freedom of religion in their lands. So it was a good connection between them, a good example for us to follow. And when they come, one day of their stay was Sunday. So they are looking for a place to pray. And Muhammad himself is showing or asking them to pray in his own masjid, in his own mosque. So they perform their praise, practice their prayers in the masjid of the Prophet at the time. And like Najran Christians, there are several other small communities in Arabian Peninsula at the time of Muhammad, and most of them are getting assurance documents. What I mean, they are agreeing to pay some taxes, and the state, the Islamic State, is assuring their, or assure to protect their freedom of religion in their lands. And one of them is St. Catherine, Church of Mount Sinai, for example. And there are several other small Christian groups in that area who get these assurance documents at the time. And we should also mention that, you know, at this time for Islam, there was a period of speedy spread of the religion and also expansion of the empire, expansion of the state. I purposely differentiate them because Muslims at a time share borders, for example, with Byzantine Empire. And there is, of course, there became some diplomatic relationship or some political economic relationship. And in this time period, there are basically two reactions from Christian world. In terms of small Christian groups, they basically agreed to pay taxes and to get protection from the state because the taxes which they are paying to the central government generally higher than the taxes which they will pay for the new empire, for the Islamic empire. So you can see many small groups are becoming, or it is the one of the reason why Islamic empire expand speed in so quickly. And in other way, like I said, there was two type of reactions. There are some political authorities who don't like the spread of a new empire in their land. Even at time of Muhammad, for example, the Christian army and the Muslim army came against each other. For the first one, Muhammad did not command the army, the Muslim army. There was, in the records, they said that there was 12 Muslim lost. If you can assume the Byzantine Empire's army is bigger than Muslims' army, it can easily be said that their loss was lower than 12. So it was the first kind of warfare connection between Christians and Muslims. And second one, also at time of Muhammad, Muhammad is coming together with his army, commanding the army, going to the north of Jordan right now, south of Syria, the valley of Yarmouk. But though both army came to the battlefield, they don't fight. So they go back to their lands because the issue is solved with diplomacy rather than a conflict. So you see that, you know, there the early era also shows some political connections or encounters and also economic encounters between these two communities. And later on, these connections, these encounters continues. And one of the good example is Umar's getting to Jerusalem. So when Umar came into Jerusalem, he gave guarantees of civil and religious liberty to Christians. And when the Patriarch of Jerusalem invited him to pray in the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, Umar declined it, fearing that Muslims who follow him as a leader may want to pray in the same location, in the same place later in the future. So there can be a conflict between Christians and Muslims. Because of that fear, he did not pray in the church. Rather, he prayed next to the church. Right now, there is a mosque next to the Church of Sepulchre because of that reason. So then how the connections evolved, you can see, Muslims even create or control a land in today's Spain in Europe. And Father Badi explained very well the scholarly connections between two cultures. Al-Andalus was beacon of learning for centuries in Spain. Cordoba was the largest city in Europe and became one of the leading cultural and economic center throughout the Mediterranean basin, Europe and Islamic world. It became as a conduit for cultural and scientific exchange, which Father Badi gave great examples related to that. It was also a key center of Jewish life, you know, not just Muslims and Christians, part of that scholarly exchange. Also Jewish community was part of that scholarly exchange and producing important scholars, and one of the most stable and wealthy Jewish communities was living in Spain, in today's Spain, in Andalus, Al-Andalus. So then, Crusades began in the 12th century, in the 11th century, let me say. But even in times of that conflictual point, there are several great dialogue examples, which again, Father Badi gave examples. Let me also give two examples. Salahuddin, you can watch a movie, The Kingdom of Heavens. I like to enjoy to watch it when I was in university times. But, even in the battlefield, there was great dialogue examples, which we can look at and get role models, get some examples, even in times of conflict. And St. Francis, the dialogue between St. Francis and Sultan al-Kamil was another example. Because Father Badi mentioned it, I am just skipping it. And then Ottoman era is coming. Ottomans is controlling Balkan eras right now. And it was having a millet system, so given communal autonomy to many communities. And you can easily get the area by looking at the demographics. For example, my home city is a small city in Anatolia, in east part of Turkey, called Elazığ. In 19th century, almost 40%, more than 30% of the population was Christian. Unfortunately, after nationalization, after so many conflicts in 20th century, we lost that multicultural area, but Ottoman Empire was successful to protect or to have that multicultural arena, multicultural towns, multicultural cities in times of 600 years. Then after Ottoman Empire, we had modern time connections. I don't talk each of them deeply. I want to talk just briefly, mention the names, because many people have some ideas on all of them or today's situation. So colonization era, the world wars was opening the 20th century. The first half of the 20th century was conflictual, and all of the world was affected by that. Then after 1950s, we slowly see the effect of globalization, especially in the last 30 decades. We hugely see the effect of easy transportation, easy communication, and also mass immigration. So all of them are shaped today's encounters, today's connections between these two big communities. But briefly, I will come to my final thoughts. But we should, I think, separate the encounters with a Muslim majoritarian state or a Christian majoritarian state and the encounters with Muslims and Christians. I mean, the countries may share border, sometimes have border conflicts or have some diplomatic or non-diplomatic relationship between each other, but the communication between people is not limited with that. So we should differentiate that. A relationship between Roman Empire and a Muslim country does not mean a relationship between Muslims and Christians. And let me come to my final thoughts. By the way, Father Badi also mentioned the Second Vatican Council, some ideas in that council. I personally, as a Muslim, appreciate the Pope's, the Catholics' effort in this Vatican Council. And I think it was a great advantage to shape today's environment and to open the avenues for dialogue in the future and in right now in today's contemporary world. And for final thought, I will give an example. It is a relationship between Muslims and Jewish, my personal experience. My wife, we had our first daughter in Brooklyn, New York, and the name of the hospital which we went was Maimonides Hospital. 2 years ago, and my daughter is right now 7 years old, by the way. And 2 years ago, I learned that Maimonides is a Jewish scholar and one of the basically most prolific and influential Torah scholars of the Middle Ages lived in Egypt actually exiled in Spain, then go to Morocco, then Egypt, and have many connections with Muslims. And when we had our first babies, when my wife delivered her, she was stressed, and it was not, let me say, an easy delivery for her. She was at time was 22, I was 26, 27, and we were very much stressed. And two doula, two Jewish lady, old Jewish lady came and, you know, took our stresses. And my wife at the time had to use, epidural. Yeah, epidural. And they came and they just talked with us, remind to us the God's mercy. And after my wife had medicine, one of the Jewish ladies just fixed her headscarf at the time. And I very much liked it. I very much liked her respect, the Jewish lady's respect toward others. And personally, I think that every of us, each of us, deserve at least that level of respect. And each of us are responsible. It is our duty to show at least that level of respect. Later on, to be honest, I prayed for them a lot because they released our stress when we are young, when we are expecting our first baby in our, when we are waiting to embrace our first baby. So I think it was a great way to get in communication, first to respect the position, to respect the ideas, and to get human connections, basic human connections, regardless of faith, nation, race, and so on. Thanks for listening. Again, I'm looking forward to your questions.
Thank you, Dr. Fevzi. We have a question from the Muslim community, Father Buddy. The question goes, what would Father Buddy suggest us Muslim friends so that we can have dialogue with Christian friends, even with the ones who might have prejudgments?
Great question. So I think that simply trying to meet with each other to invite the others to gather, to especially after we get a vaccine, of course, open the door, extend an invitation, say, you know, we would love for you to come in and meet us and understand us. We would like to explain our faith to you. We would like to share our faith with you. And know that this is simply an exposition of the faith. And, you know, we think that you would find a lot of points of commonality. So come on over. And I know we had a program that I think Atlas participated in through our East Jefferson Interfaith Clergy Association several years ago called Faiths of Our Neighbors. And the Abu Bakr Mosque in Metairie was opened up one evening for an open house. And it was, you know, people in the neighborhood, different traditions in the neighborhood and Metairie area opened up their homes of worship as well. We would have one every other month or so. And when Abu Bakr opened its doors to the larger community, I think that it was standing room only. And they performed evening prayers, and then we had a presentation from the imam at the time, food. And something like that, you know, just an invitation. And if there are hard questions, it's always good to have a more experienced Christian speaker there to help with the with the harder questions, perhaps, or the ones that might say, well, why do you not do this? And why, you know, I'll always volunteer to come help. But I think that if you have an honest discussion and openness, you know, people are going to come and you know, they want to learn, you know, and say, please come and learn. There has been also, even during this difficult time with COVID, a relationship that has developed between the Abu Bakr community and the Islamic community in Metairie, in West Metairie, and the Vineyard Evangelical Christian Church in Kenner. They have gotten close to each other. They have had dialogue sessions on Saturdays. They had Christians and Muslims. There's this common presentation, and they break into small groups and then have food. And they've helped each other out. Vineyard has helped Abu Bakr to give out food, to give them funding to help their feeding program during the lockdown, and other acts of kindness and compassion together. These are the kinds of things that build our communities up and help us to get to know each other better and to appreciate each other better as brothers and sisters in faith. And I'll mention one more thing. I know I'm going a long time. I'll give a shout out to Jenny Yanez, who worked so hard at Abu Bakr. Helped us distribute some of our blessing bags, which was Philip's idea, and he stepped away right now from his screen, but helped us get started with the idea of doing blessing bags for the homeless, to give to the homeless at street corners if they're there, to have a little plastic bag of goodies for them, including a bottle of water, socks, a toothbrush, energy bar, and maybe put in a couple of dollars and hand it to them. Well, Jenny got a bunch of those from us, and she went downtown with them, and she invited the Mormons to go with her. So you had Mormons and Muslims giving out blessing bags to the homeless in the streets of New Orleans, and inside was a little note that said, "Compliments of Our Lady of Prop Sucker Catholic Church in West Wego." So we call that M&M Ministry. So, you know, there are wonderful possibilities there. So I invite the Islamic community to open their doors and to say hello to everyone.
Thank you. Trinity Episcopal Church that I'm part of has shared Atlas Foundation conversations and dialogues for a number of years. And last several years, we've had iftar dinners with Atlas, and just bringing both of our communities together to share the common experience and to talk about our love and our faith together, and just talk about who we are as people has brought a great deal of understanding and commonality. Fevzi, would you like to say some more about this?
I mean, you both said great things. I can say that there are kind of different levels of dialogue. One of them is dialogue between scholars, and it needs a special effort among scholars. You know, Al-Andalus, for example, in Spain, there was, you know, Muslim students of a Christian teacher or Christian students of a Muslim scholars, or Jewish, you can add Jewish scholars too. And there is another sphere of communication, dialogue between people, or regular communication. And I think it is more natural. Common projects, it is one way to get come together, like Jenny is distributing to homelessness. Or a home dinner, drinking a coffee in a Starbucks. Don't kind of propose big things in your mind. I will organize the dinner for 1,000 people. It's not like that. Coming together and drinking coffee just represent your, show your willing to come together. Show your aspiration for dialogue, and it opens many doors for everybody, I think.
Another local example of Christians and Muslims and Jews getting together is Quran study that is taking place in the New Orleans area with Jewish people and Christian people and Muslims, which is just magnificent. We have about 5 minutes left, and I was wondering, Dr. Fevzi and Father Buddy, could you all speak to us more about the Hizmet movement? We've talked about that some a couple of weeks ago, and how the Hizmet movement is bringing people together, as we've been speaking of, and what is going on locally with people who are involved with Hizmet.
I first got involved with Hizmet and Atlas back in, and I think I mentioned this at the very beginning, back in 2003, when I had a knock on my office door, a member of Atlas, my Turkish friend, Femi Karadenis, came and visited, and he told me about Atlas. And it was a parishioner of mine at Holy Name of Jesus, Kathy Eustace, who co-founded Atlas just a couple of years before. And I got involved with Atlas thereafter and have been involved ever since. And I think it is the kind of organization, and there are many sister organizations like it around the world, all of them applying these principles of interreligious dialogue and cooperation. Hizmet means charity in Arabic, and charity on many different levels, charity in the sense of personal outreach, and also respect for each other's traditions. And all of that is, you know, the work of Fethullah Gulen, Hoja Effendi, who lives up in the Pocono Mountains in Pennsylvania, a Turkish Muslim scholar, who sees the importance of dialogue and has made friends around the world. And sadly, people sometimes don't understand him. I can let Fevzi talk more to that. But I just think it's a wonderful organization, and all the sister organizations like it that do so much good in the world, and especially also are involved in education of children around the world in various countries. So I'll be quiet now and let Fevzi talk.
Okay. I mean, I introduced with Hizmet movement when I was in my middle school years, I can say that. After my early ages, after I can really think, after my childhood ages, I became part of the movement. And I can easily say that, you know, there are some problems in our world, in our contemporary world, like any other era, and we need some specific efforts to solve this problem. And the movement specified three main problems. One of them is ignorance. Ignorance of the people. So we can have more educational efforts. We can have more schools to educate the people. And second, we have poverty problem. So we need to something, some charity organizations, some people to devote themselves to solve this problem, some businessmen to put some efforts to solve the problems. And third, we have a polarization problem, big polarization problem. I mean, you can see in every place some radical organizations, and they are widespread in media. They are widespread in our life. They are affecting each and every of our lives. So how we can deal with that problem? With dialogue, with communication, with coming together, not with talking a lot, but we are representing. We are showing that we can come together. So I did learn from his mad movement, actions are louder than words. So in each of my lifetime, I'm trying to show that, yes, we can do something with education, or Hizmet did encourage, did promote many people do great things in the field of education, in the field of charity, or in the field of dialogue, in the field of respecting others, but not just talking a lot, by showing a lot, by going to their doors, not accepting them in their places, but just knocking the doors, knocking every possible doors in wherever they are living. So that was all I can say. I can talk some contemporary issues related to Turkish politics. I skip it right now because it is more theological course format, but I can absolutely talk whenever it is feasible.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Fevzi. Thank you, Father Buddy. I think what we've been doing these past 6 weeks has been an example and an experience of people from different faiths and experiences coming together to share our questions and our time together and to learn more, not only about our one God, but also each other. And it's a good way to promote understanding and peace. This is the conclusion of our series. We hope that it has been inspirational, educational, and enjoyable. We will soon send you an email thanking you for participation and asking for your evaluation of the series and your suggestions for other classes. Before we leave, we want to invite you to two fascinating follow-up presentations, which begin next week. October 22nd, Thursday, Jesus and Islam will be presented by Dr. Ziki Toprak from John Carroll University. And then the following week, October 29, Dialogue of Civilizations by Dr. Craig Considine from Rice University. Again, thank you for being part of this class. Thank you, Father Buddy, Dr. Fevzi, for your teaching. Thank you, Hassan Suzuk, for keeping us online and helping us with technical issues. Good night, and may the God of love, mercy, forgiveness, unity, and peace be with and keep us all and all of God's people tonight and always. Thank you and good night. Bye-bye.